So,
hi everyone, I'm Domenico Stigliani, biomedical engineer and CEO of Manava Plus, an innovative startup that develops neural interfaces in Italy and Switzerland. My speech today is divided into three parts. The first, I will explore the definition of man from a scientific perspective, according to the most recent theories. This part will include an incisive critique regarding the historical development of our understanding of men, both in medical and engineering fields. In the second part, I will focus on neural interfaces and how they extend human capabilities. In the third and final part, I will focus on the topic of robotic immortality, trying to demonstrate its feasibility and importance. Let's start with the fundamental question, what is an object? Take the example of a galaxy. From a scientific perspective, a galaxy can be analyzed and measured in various ways. We can determine its size, understand how many and what kind of such objects it comprises, study its motion in direction with other parts of the universe, and its own components, as well as the various electromagnetic radiation it emits. Now, reflect on this. If a galaxy, a subject of numerous studies in astronomy and astrophysics, is considered an object, then we can deduce that a star is also an object. Consequently, a planet also falls into the category of objects. Extending this reason further, we can state that animals present on a planet are objects too. Following this logic, even human must be classified as objects. These viewpoints invite us to reconsider our traditional perception of objects and our place in the universe. This leads to the assertion that the traditional dichotomy between subject and object is actually a false problem. Essentially, the idea of the subject loses its meaning. It becomes more logical and consistent to speak exclusively in terms of object. Now, consequently, we consider the human being not as a subject, but rather as an object, specifically a biological machine. This approach should be intuitive and easily understandable for neurologists, physicians, and biologists who are accustomed to interpreting humans in biological and mechanical terms. A perspective that may be less immediate for those outside this field. In this view, the human being is analyzed and understood through its biological and mechanical functions, rather than based on traditional philosophical or psychological categories. Let's examine the reflex arc, a phenomenon that has become familiar through the so-called patellar reflex, the mechanism by which striking the tendon below the knee with a hammer reflexively triggers the knee to kick with the contraction of the quadriceps. What can the reflex arc tell us about the human being seen as an object? It shows that even a seemingly simple behavior like that of the reflex arc shares a common structure even in more complex contexts. Let's look at it in detail. The process begins with a sensation, for example, the strike of a hammer follows with a minimal amount of mental processing in the thought and concludes with a physical response, the movement of the leg raising. This pattern of stimulus, processing, and response is a constant model that is not only for objects in the strict sense, but also for animals and extends further for human beings, who according to this view are also being considered objects. The notion of the reflex arc thus helps us to understand that the reactions and behaviors of human beings can be seen through the same mechanical and biological prism we apply to other natural objects. Ultimately, the behavior model of any object, including humans, follows the pattern of stimulus, processing, and response. When we consider concepts like the pineal gland, the platonic soul, or other system proposed to justify specific human behaviors or the presence of consciousness, we are faced with the mere hypothesis lacking empirical foundation. In contrast, if we accept that the universal model of any entity, object, animals, or human beings is based on sensation through a moment, we can have a clear and controlled view of process. This approach allows us to move beyond speculative assumption and ourselves in a more concrete and verifiable understanding of actions and reactions in the world. By interpreting phenomena through this framework, we can achieve a greater mechanical and biological understanding of behavior, not only human, but of any form of life or entity. So, stimulus, processing, and response. The brain, within the context of stimulus, processing, and response model, the brain assumes the role of an intermediate element within the reflex arc. In this structure, we have a sensor on one side, then the brain, and finally an actuator. The brain, therefore, is nothing more than a part of this reaction mechanism, an essential link between the perception of a stimulus and the physical response. The view reduces the tendency to overestimate or overcomplicate the role of the brain with empirically unsupported theories, such as those regarding Roger Penrose's microtubules. Seen in this light, such theories lack substance. In this framework, the brain is simply a necessary component in a broader process of processing and response, without attributing to it functions or capacities that go behind its actual mechanism and biological scope. Now, let's consider the experience of brain fields, which have traditionally been interpreted in a certain way and try to see them in a new light. I refer to the approach of Riccardo Manzotti, a bioengineer and a philosopher. In his text, The Extended Mind, Manzotti offers an alternative interpretation of the experience conducted by Penfield, in which the patient, in a state of consciousness, reported unexpected sensory experience during the stimulation of specific brain areas. Manzotti suggests that in this case, Penfield was merely manipulating the inhibitory areas of the brain. These areas function like a sort of gates that, once opened, allows the manifestation of pre-existing conscious experiences. For example, when a patient under stimulation reported seeing someone enter the operating room, an event clearly not real at the moment, according to Manzotti, what was happening was that the patient's brain was reactivating a past experience, making it present again in the patient's consciousness. In this way, the experience lived by the patient seeing the person enter had a foundation in reality due to the intervention of the brain's inhibitory areas that allowed the experience to continue to be lived. To better illustrate this concept, let's consider an interesting visual Pele, which is actually a work of art. Imagine looking at an image. If you only observe the left part, you might have a difficulty to understand what it is. But by changing perspective and looking at the entire image, you might recognize the figure of Nikola Tesla, composed of a series of television, printed parts, and so on. What does this example teach us about experience? It shows us that what we perceive a conscious experience, like the experience by the patient during Penfield's experience, is nothing but the spatio-temporal composition of elements with which our body comes into contact. Essentially, our consciousness does not autonomously generate these images or sensations, rather, it assembles and interprets external stimuli to create the experience we live. This process of assembly and interpretation is fundamental to understanding the nature of conscious experience and the way we interact with the world. Dream is perception. This statement leads to the conclusion that even dreams are intense and meaningful forms of perception. Contrary to common belief, dreams are not the fruit of our imagination or memories stored like in a computer, ready to be reactivated. Rather, following Mazzotti's theory, dreams are perceptions, assemblies of spatiotemporal experiences that our body has already lived and continues to live while dreaming. To further explore this concept, consider a simple experiment. Have you ever dreamed about something you have never perceived in the past? We cannot dream of flying if we have never had a similar experience. However, when we dream of flying, we are actually combining different experiences we have lived, like swimming, falling, or flying in an airplane. These experiences merge in the dream, creating a sensation of flight that is in fact an assembly of past perception that continue in the present of the dreamer. This approach to dreams as perceptions may seem controversial or atypical, but it offers a more concrete explanation grounded in the reality of human experiences. So, what is a man? After deconstructing and then reconstructing our knowledge, we arrive at the fundamental question. What is a man? Simplifying, we can say that a human is an object composed of sensors, a brain, actuators, and objects which we interact. If we analyze carefully, removing any element from this circuit, the human being chooses to exist. It is, in a literary sense, dead. Consider the actuators. Even a patient in a coma who have a beating heart and breathes artificially is a part of this scheme. The same goes for the brain. Without it, the connection between the sensor and the actuator is interrupted, making human function impossible. Similarly, cannot exist without an object to interact with. Think of the thought experiment of the brain in a vat. An isolated brain in a vat does not constitute a human being, as it lacks connection with the world with an object. Even if one attempts to isolate the individual under a bell jar, oxygen becomes the indispensable object for this existence. In the end, what then defines a human? We cannot exclude the perceived object, nor the actuator, the brain, or the senses. A human is the sum of all these elements, an interconnected and independent circle, where each component is essential for the very definition of human. Let's see. The view leads us to reconsider the very essence of the human being, not as an isolated entity, but as an inseparable part of the world. Recognizes that assimilating this concept can be complex, we now move on to discuss neural interfaces, the second part of these discussions. Why neural interfaces? Because if we interpret the brain according to our previous definition, it is nothing more than a structure equipped with numerous gates, essentially a large inhibitor. However, this inhibitor at certain times must open outward. Neural interfaces play a crucial role in this process of opening. They allow the brain to connect and interact with other objects in ways that were not possible before. This technology represents a fundamental breakthrough in understanding and manipulating the brain-environment interaction, opening new frontiers in neuroscience and biotechnology. Through neural interfaces, we are able to overcome the natural limitation of the brain, creating direct connections between the human nervous system and external devices. This not only expands the possibilities for communication and control between the brain and other objects, but also paves the way for new treatment modalities for neurological disease and enhances human capabilities beyond traditional biological limits. Now let's focus on a relatively simple aspect, spinal implants as a form of neural interfaces. This type of interface is obviously less complex compared to the direct manipulation of the brain. Nonetheless, provides us with a concrete example of how the red circle model mentioned earlier, is not only a philosophical structure, but also a scientifically solid framework. Spinal implants demonstrate that the restoration of sensation in the legs, for example, is possible through physical contact and well-defined connections, reinforcing the idea that sensoriality and motility are integral and fundamental in defining the human being. Now let's take on a more complex topic, brain implants. There are various companies and research institutions contributing to this rapidly evolving area, including Pardromics, Synchron, and Neuralink. Synchron, founded by an Australian neurosurgeon, employs a characterization technique to invert devices into blood vessels that can read and write neural activity. These different approaches aim to create a direct connection between the brain and external devices, essentially linking the deep brain to machines. The significance of these developments is not limited to the field of neuroscience. They represent a bridge to the third part of our discussion dedicated to robotics. But implants represent a critical frontier in research on enhancing and augmenting human capabilities, offering new possibilities for the treatment of neurological disease and for the expansion of human brain functions behind natural limits. Now, artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence plays a fundamental role in the field of brain implants, especially regarding the interpretation and transfer of large amounts of neural signals. To effectively process and transmit this information from the brain to a computer, it is essential to have an advanced system, typically an artificial intelligence algorithm. The system is the core that enables the connection between the biological component, the human brain, and the electronic component, namely external devices. The use of AI in this context is not just a matter of efficiency. It is unnecessary for translating complex neural activities into data that are comprehensible and usable by non-biological systems. This technology bridges the gap between the human brain and the digital world, opening new possibilities for human-machine interaction and enhancing cognitive abilities through the use of external devices. Essentially, AI is the key to unlocking the potential of brain-computer interfaces, transforming sophisticated neural activities in concrete actions and analyzable data. Let's look in detail the human-machine interface scheme. On one side of the scheme, we have the human, and on the other, we have the neural interface. The crucial factor for the effectiveness of the neural interface is the amount of information exchange that occurs between the two brains, namely the biological and the electronic. The more active and rich this communication exchange is, the greater the efficiency of the interface. This principle is similar to what happens in human communities. For example, in a couple, which communication is fundamental for the smooth functions of the relationship. The key issue in neural interfaces, therefore, is the bit rate, that is the amount of data that we can exchange between the brain and the computer, both in terms of reading and writing. This data transfer rate is vital in determining how effectively we can transfer complex information to and from the brain, directly influencing the ability of these interfaces to function as effective bridges between the biological and the electronic. Ultimately, the success of neural interfaces depends on our ability to optimize this information exchange, making them powerful tools for expanding human capabilities and for treatment of various neurological conditions. The Hogan twins. Now let's examine an interesting case, that of the Hogan twins, born in Canada. Joined not only at the skull, but also sharing a part of the brain, the thalamus, the Hogan twins present unique characteristics from both a medical and engineering perspective. A surprising aspect is that Tatiana, a twin, can see through the eyes of Krista, a phenomenon that significantly strengthens the theories discussed earlier. The case challenges numerous traditional conceptions of mind, such as the conception of qualia. The connection between the twins through the thalamus means that when one closes her eyes, she can continue to see through the eyes of the other. If one twin can see through the eyes of the other, it wouldn't be unreasonable to assume she could also receive other forms of communications, which we define as mental. This observation challenged traditional hypotheses about the mind, soul, and consciousness, showing that biological reality presents concrete facts that sweep away fanciful speculations. Now we move to the third part of our discussion, where we will explore how immortality might be achieved through robotic augmentation. Having understood the nature of humans, how they can connect to computers through neural interfaces, we now turn on our attention to soft robotics. Traditionally, robotics has been associated with the industry, with robots characterized by a rigid and hard structure. However, to integrate robotics into the lives of human beings, who are soft by nature, it is necessary to develop soft robotics. This bench of robotics was to create robots that are flexible, adaptable, and more similar in structure and behavior to human beings. An example is the integration of an artificial hand, which, although not completely soft in this case, represents a step in this direction. The development of soft robotics is crucial to make technology more acceptable and integrable into the daily lives of humans, not just as a work tool, but also as an integral part of our physical and social existence. Ultimately, soft robotics aims to overcome the traditional barriers between man and machine, increasingly bridging robots closer to the physical characteristics and functionalities of human beings, paving the way for previously unimaginable possibilities in terms of healthcare, enhancing human capabilities, and in the pursuit of immortality. The theme of augmentation in the field of prosthetics offers new perspective compared to the traditional concept of replacement. If you consider an individual who has lost a hand and acquires a prosthetic one, we can also imagine a person with two natural hands deciding to acquire a third artificial hand. This line of thinking leads us to reflect on the idea of augmentation rather than mere replacement. In contrast, physical augmentation through prosthetics is already a feasibility reality. The possibility of adding new artificial components to the human body, not only to replace lost parts, but also to enhance our extended natural capabilities, represents a field of great potential. The perspective opens the way to the new forms of human-machine interaction, where technology is not limited to repairing or replacing, but rather expands and enriches the human experience. Prosthetic augmentation could thus become a key to overcoming the physical and cognitive limits of human beings, leading us towards a future where technology and the human body coexist and collaborate in increasingly integrated and innovative ways. To illustrate the concept of augmentation rather than replacement or substitution, augmentation is not substitution, consider the example of a plant growing from a seed. If we measure the amount of matter over time of the seed and the rest of the plant, we realize that the seed becomes an increasingly less predominant part compared to the entire plant. This leads us to reflect on the nature of identity and change. Although I am now an adult, the identity of the child I once was, announced to the seed, is still a part of me, although it is no longer the predominant characteristics. This analogy is fundamental to understanding how we can integrate our biological component with a robotic one. In the context of our augmentation, we are not replacing our biology, but rather adding elements that expand and enrich it. Just as the plant growing from the seed maintains its original core while expanding, so can we humans integrate robotic components that extend our network capabilities, maintaining our basic identity. This approach to augmentation allows us to explore now new possibilities for growth and development, always maintaining a connection to our biological origin and essence. Let's start from the idea that initially we are composed of 99% biological elements and 1% robotic elements. The glasses we wear, the watches, the phones are already extensions of ourselves, and in a certain sense can be considered as prosthetics. Now, imagine that these components progressively increases over time with the addition of soft robotics components. Let's call soft avatar our twin part that grows in capability. As we integrate more and more components through the neural interfaces, the soft avatar will become predominant compared to the rest. The biological part remains unchanged, where the avatar grows in importance, eventually reaching, let's say, 99%, leaving 1% biological. This brings us to a point of comparison with the twins Tatiana and Krista. Initially, we are like one of the twins, largely biological, but with the increase of the soft avatar, we increasingly identify with it. Consider a practical example for to reflect on the implication of augmentation through the soft avatar in humans. Imagine that a person through a neural interface, this one, connected to a camera or a device like Amazon Kindle, can read a million books a week instead of just one book a week, as they would normally do. This situation raises an interesting question. Where does our culture, our being knowledgeable, come from? If the biological part of us reads one book a week, but the soft part reads a million books in the same span of time, which of the two parts has a greater impact of our cultural identity? In this scenario, it is the soft avatar that more significantly defines who we are, as it has a capacity for learning and lived experience that is enormously superior compared to our biological part.
But the question, in the end, it's the original part who interprets the books.
It's the robotic part that interprets the books, not the biological part.
No,
I will respond.
When you read the book, you may have different opinions.
This part.
But you get knowledge.
He reads 1 million books. This part, one book. But it's the same entity. It's the same entity. Like when the brain is guts.
But two different people read 100 books.
No. These are not two different people, are the same people, one people,
yeah,
with a biological part and a robotic part. It's the same people. You are the same you with your glasses. You and your glasses are one person.
We will be all the same.
Then I conclude this the presentation. So,
andiamo dopo le domande.
Yes, thank you. So, while the biological twin experiences 1 year, meanwhile the soft twin experiences 1 million years. I now want to talk about emotions. That's what they are seeing together.
There's a Hebrew from the top that says, whoever saves one life saves the world in time. Okay, why do we cry when we watch this scene? Because the actor becomes one with the character.
The character cries and it is authentic. The actual cries and is not pretending, but he also authentic. We cry because we deeply feel that the actor is truly sad. But how can an actor be truly sad and not just pretending? According to the Stanislavski method, this actor evokes personal emotions, allowing him to authentically manifest the character's emotion. What is the sad experience that Liam Neeson has lived through and conveys to us with such intensity? We don't know, but we know it is authentic. What do we learn from all this? That to have emotions, you must have experiences. Emotion does not spring from the soul of something mysterious, but from lived experiences. Having an earth means having experiences. No experience, no earth. In the context of advanced robotics and artificial intelligence, debate often arises about emotion in robots. Contrary to the idea that robots can only simulate emotions, my thesis is that, like in the case of actors, robots are capable of genuinely experiencing emotions by experiences in the world. Finally, we come to our immortality and consider the perspective in which inevitably the biological part of us, which is to exist, leaving only the soft outer alive. In this vision of the future, our understanding of reality, art, science could be so advanced that, for example, Beethoven's symphony might seem as simple as a children's song to us. As our augmented beings will be capable of convincing ideas and creations much more complex and profound. Essentially, this path to immortality is not just about overcoming physical limits, but also about expanding and transcending the boundaries of our mind and consciousness. Concluding, what will make us immortal? A neural interface that joins our biological body to our robotic twin. A soft avatar that lives, experiences, and feels emotion. The highly intelligent, deeply human, and every youthful avatar is us. Thank you.